Hello and welcome back for another video session. And as you know, we are looking at the unit 4, combinational logic circuits, and this is the 10th session in this unit. So far, we have looked into the properties of Boolean algebra, the canonical and standard forms, different logic gates, how we can reduce the Boolean expressions using Carnot map we have seen, and how we can simplify the POS, product of sums we have seen, and how to use the don't care conditions we have seen, and we have seen how why this NAND and NOR gates are called the universal gates. We have seen the XOR function and the binary adder, subtractor, decimal adder, multiplier, the magnitude comparator, decoders. In this session, we will look into the encoders. So, as I mentioned in the previous session about the decoders, so what does a decoder do? It will take n input and convert it into m outputs, where m is equal to 2 power n. All right, suppose if I have two inputs, 2 power 2 will be 4. So if I give two inputs, output will be 4. In a similar way, what does an encoder do? It will take m inputs and give out n outputs, where m is equal to 2 power n. It can be equal to 2 power n or less than that. All right. So that is what is an encoder that will do. Now, let us look at the octal to binary encoder. So that means we are going to take a binary number, I mean, we are going to take an octal number and convert it into a binary number. Now, for those of you who don't know what an octal number is, let me write here. Okay, so we know binary number. So binary number uses only two digits, that is 0 and 1. All right, so any number can be represented using only these two digits, 0 and 1. So when you say a decimal number, you know any number can be represented using the digit 0 to 9, that is 10 numbers, 10 digits, right? Similarly, when you say octal number, it will represent any number using 8 digits. What are those 8 digits? 0 to 7 will be the 8 digits. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So those are the 8 digits. So suppose if I write 56 is the decimal value. All right. So 56 is the decimal value. Then if I want to convert this into the octal number, then what I have to do is I have to go on dividing this by 8. So whenever we convert from the decimal to any other, then we have to divide that number by the new base. That is, octal is to base 8. All right. So therefore, so if you divide this 56, so what we get? Eight, how many times? Eight sevens are 8 sevens are 56, and then remainder is 0. All right, so we write this as 70 or 70. We don't call it as 70 now because this is converted into the octal number, so we represent this as 70 to base 8. This is how we represent. So 70 in octal is equal to 56 decimal. So this is equal to what? this is equal to 56 to base 10. So if you don't write anything, it is understood that it is to base 10. So normally we will put a bracket, the parenthesis, and write 10 here to say that it is a base 10 number. This is the base 8 number or the octal number, or this is the decimal number. So when we want to convert the decimal number 56 into octal, so it will have 70 or 70. We don't call 70 because there is no, it will be wrong to say this, read it as 70 because we call this as 70. So this will be the, now this is octal. Now octal is a binary, this is called as a grouped binary. All right, and one more is the hexadecimal, where the number you're going to divide by 16. Suppose if you want to convert this decimal number into hexadecimal, we divide by 16. If you want to convert the decimal into binary, we divide by 2. All right, so that is all the by the basis. So the hexadecimal, octal, and binary, they are all related. Okay. So octal and hexadecimal are called as grouped binary, because if you group the, I mean, each hexadecimal is represented using 4 bits. All right. So because hexadecimal means it will have from numbers 0, it will have to base 16. That means we have only 0 to 9 digits, that is 10 digits. Then how do we call it hexadecimal? That means how do we get 16? So along with the 0 to 9, that is 10 digits, we also have A, B, C, D, A, B, C, D, E, F. So therefore, 0 to 9 and A to F totally counts A to F. So we'll have totally 16 digits to represent the hexadecimal number. All right. And when we are representing each hexadecimal number, we use 4 bits. For 0, it is 0, 0, 0, 0, all the 4 bits being zeros. And F is all the 4 bits being 1. All right. All the 4 bits being 1 is for F. And all the 4 bits being zeros is for, I'm just writing it because, this is for 0. So I'm going to write 0 as all the 4 bits being zeros and F being all the 4 bits being 1. So in between we'll have all the other combinations. All right. So this is called the hexadecimal. And octal, if I'm going to, that is nothing but 0 to 7 only we'll be representing, right? So 0 to 7, to we can count how many digits? 8 digits, including 0, it is 8 digits. So therefore, to represent how do we represent 7 in binary, decimal 7 in binary is 1, 1, 1, right? That is 3. So therefore, and how do we represent 0? So we can represent using 3 bits. So this is the octal. So octal number we are going to have between from 0 to 7. Next, after 7, what will happen? 1, 0. Then 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 1, 6, 1, 7. After 1, 7, what will be the next number? It will be 2, 0. Not 1, 8, because 8 is not an octal number. Okay, 8 can be a decimal or it can come in the hexadecimal, not in the octal. So octal will have only 0 to 1. Just like how binary, in binary, what is the first number? 0. Next number? 1. Next? 1, 0. 1, 1. 1, 0, 0. 1, 0, 1. 1, 1, 0. 1, 1, 1. And so on, right? So the number of bits, digits keep on increasing very quickly in binary. In octal, after every 7 counts, the number will increase. Digits will increase. In decimal number, after 10 counts, the number will increase from 1 digit to 2 digit. Like for example, from 0 to 9, if you count, I mean, we start counting from 0 to 9, then come 10. 10 is a two-digit number. Then again, we from 10 to 19, we count. Then at 20, the number changes to so and so on, right? So like that, we see that there are changes there. So similarly, now the octal number will change from 0 to 7. Then after 7 is 10, then 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. Then 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27. After 27, 30, 31, 32, and so on. Now, what I'm trying to say here is that these are called as grouped binary, that is hexadecimal and octal number. So any octal number you write it in the any binary number, if you just group it into, suppose if I have a binary number sequence like this 1 1 1 0 0 1 1, blindly I'm just writing some number. Now what is the value of this binary number? I do not know. Now if I want to convert this into the decimal, I have to start multiplying each position, and so this bit into 2 power 0, this bit into 2 power 1, this bit into 2 power 2, this bit into 2 power 3, this bit into 2 power 4, this into 2 power 5, this into 2 power 6. So when I add all that, then I get the answer for this. So that is how I convert from binary to decimal. Now, if I want to convert the binary number to octal or hexadecimal, it is very easy. How? Octal, you know, each octal number digit can be represented using 3 binary bits, right? 3 bits. So therefore, if I group this number into 3, then I get the octal number. Now, for the missing, I have to simply add zeros there. All right. So what is 001 is nothing but 6. 001 is 3, 2, and this is 3. And what is 110 is 6. And here there are no, you have to group it into 3. This is having only one digit, but the remaining two digits you have to add 0, so that will become 1. So 163 octal is equal to 1110011. Binary. All right. Now, if I want to convert it to hexadecimal, I have to group it into 4. So I have to start always with the least significant bit and move towards the most significant bit. So I'm grouping these 4 together and these 4. So these 4 form one digit and these 4 form one hexadecimal digit. So this is nothing but 3 again. And this is nothing but 7. So what is 7? 3 hexadecimal. So we write like hexadecimal is 2 base 16. Okay. So 73 base 16 is equal to 163 to base 8 is equal to 1110011 to base 2. Now you can convert this into decimal also. So the same number represent using different bases or different number system, that is the binary number system, the octal number system, and hexadecimal number system. So I hope the point of octal is clear. So octal is a grouped binary. All right. Okay. Now let us come back to our point. So we have the octal number. And you know that the octal number will have from 0 to 7. So that will count 8. Octal means 8. So you would have heard of octa-core. So what is that? It means there are 8 cores for processor. 8 partitions. Or 8 cores for processing. Alright? That's all. Okay. Now, we have the 8 inputs and we want to do the binary encoder. Now this has to be, now as I said, it will have an encoder will have 2 power n inputs and n outputs. So this is 8 means what will be n will be equal to 3. So therefore, I have 8 inputs and 3 outputs. All right. So these 8 inputs have to be now coded into 3 bits or 3 outputs. So therefore, I have these 8 inputs D0 to D1. So how do I code that? So we see that when D0 is 1, all others are zeros. So X, Y, Z. So this is coded as 0, 0, 0. All right. So this is the binary code for this number. I mean, we just call this as octal, means any one bit only is high. Of course, here we are not actually taking the octal number as 0 to 7. So we are just telling that we are giving any one of the bits to be high, to say that I'm having 8 inputs and that I'm going to convert it into 3 outputs. All right. So when I have D1, Z is 1, and X and Y both are zeros. Of course, X is the most significant bit and Z is the least significant bit. So like this, I can go on having for the 7 different combinations. I mean, so the 8 different combinations, I have the 8 outputs. Now, what is the problem with this? Suppose if I say that D3 and D6 both are 1 simultaneously. Let us consider an example. So therefore, what will be the output code? Now here we are saying only one input should be high at any given point of time. But for some reason, let us say 2 inputs are high, and let that be D3 and D6, just for our consideration. So when D6 is high, which will be high? When D6 is high, X and Y, it should be coded as X is 1 and Y is 1. Right, and Z should be 0. When D3 is high, what should it be coded as? Y should be 1 and Z should be 1. So when D3 and D6 both are 1, what will happen at the output code? We will get 1 1 1 for this combination. Yeah, 1 1 1. That means X also will be 1, Y also will be 1, Z also will be equal to 1. Okay, which will not be correct, because it should be 1 1 1 is neither the code for D3 nor the code for D6, right? So therefore, we have got the code, we have got a wrong code for the violation of this condition. So therefore, this truth table has to be modified. That I mean, what we are going to do here is we can't just implement the truth table directly. We have to implement one extra condition here. So if you take the write the equations for the outputs, for which Z is 1, so it is 1 for when D0 is 1, or when D3 is 1, or when D5 is 1, or D7 is 1. When will be Y equal to 1? When D2 is high, or D3 is high, or D6 or D7. Similarly, when will X be equal to 1? It will be high for when D4 is high, or D5, D6 or D7. So any of these. So this will be the output expression. Now, as I said, when 2 inputs are high simultaneously, you are getting a wrong output. So it should be now there should be a what you call now that condition should be not allowed. That condition should be avoided. So if both occurs, then who should be given the priority? That is also a question there. Right. So therefore, we see that this octal to binary conversion, that is, we are just calling this as octal to binary conversion. And so here, the condition when 2 bits are high simultaneously are not taken care. So therefore, this we have to modify. So we call that as the priority encoder. So that means when we say that, what do we mean by priority encoder is that when we say that D3 and D6 both are high, which is having the higher weightage is D6. So D6 will get the priority. Therefore, the output will be coded for D6, not for D3. As I said in the previous case, when D3, D6 both are high, we will get the output as 1111. I mean, all three ones, which is not true, which is the output for 7. I mean, D7 high, isn't it? So it should be either for D3 or D6. And D6 will overtake D3 because D6 has a higher weightage. So therefore, output should be 1-1 when both D3 and D6 are high. So similarly, when D3 and D2 are high, D3 takes over or dominates. So that we call it as a priority. So who should be given priority? So this encoder, we will always have a priority encoder. So we will see, instead of simply calling an encoder, because encoder as it is will have a lot of confusions and it will lead to a lot of ambiguity. We call it ambiguity. So that to overcome the ambiguity, we use the priority encoder. Now let us consider the truth table for a priority encoder for the same for a 4-bit. That is D0, D1, D2, D3. So these are the 4 binary bits we are going to consider. All right. So these are the, let us say we have encoded them into these 4. Now, these 4 bits we have to encode. Now let us draw the Carnot map for this and then simplify. Here X indicates that it is a don't care condition. Now when all are zeros, what will be the output? So here we are having 4 bits, 4 inputs, that is D0, D1, D2, D3. So we are having 4 inputs and we have 2 outputs, X and Y. Now this when D0, D1, D2, D3 all are zeros, then we call this as don't care condition. Why? Because we have this V is 0. Now what is this V? V is called as a valid output. So we add one extra point as a check, so which will ensure that we are having a valid input. So you know that for the priority encoder, encoder, any one of the input only should be high, and all zeros is not allowed, right? So therefore, when all are zeros, that is not a valid input. So therefore, X and Y are don't care condition and V is a 0, which says that it is not a valid output. Next, when D0 is high and all others are zeros, then X and Y, it is coded as the 0 code, that is 0 0. X and Y will be 0 0 and it is a valid output. Similarly, when D1 is high, irrespective of D0, whether D0 is 0 or 1, D1 will take over, right? So therefore, this will be coded as 0 1 and it is a valid output. Similarly, when D2 is high, D0 and D1 will be overridden by D2, because D2 is high, so D2 will be given priority. So it will be coded as 1 0. Similarly, when D3 is high, it will be coded as 1 1 for binary equivalent for 3. All right, 1 1. Okay, so here we are just considering for 2 inputs, not 4, not like the 4 inputs, unlike the 8 inputs what we had considered in the previous case. All right, so now this is what we have considered. Now let us draw the Carnot map for this. So D0, D1, D2, D3. So in this case, now D0 and D1 are the most significant bit. D2, D3 are the least significant bits. Okay, now all the don't care conditions also we are taking into consideration. Okay, now what is x? Now let us calculate for x. For the x, when is x equal to 1? It is equal to 1 whenever d2 is 1. So you go to the column where d2 is 1. So d2 is 1 here. All right. And d2 is 1 here also. So these two columns, d2 is 1. Okay. So in all those places, we have to put 1. Because irrespective of d0, d1, these two, irrespective of d0 and d1, all these combinations are 1. Right. Similarly, when is x equal to 1? When you consider for d3 also equal to 1. So all the combinations. So where is d3 equal to 1? So d3 equal to 1 is in both of these. All right. So d2 equal to 1 is in both of these conditions. So in both of these, the columns, we put 1, 1, 1, saying that d2 is 1 irrespective of d0 and d1. D0 and d1 is varying. So we are not, so only d2 is 1 in both of these. So we are putting 1, 1, 1. And where is d3 equal to 1? D3 equal to 1 is in both of these columns. But this column is already entered. So therefore, only these columns we are entering. Next, we are going to reducing. Now, if you write the min terms for each of this, there are totally 16 min terms, out of which 0 is don't care. So we don't. And for 1, 0, that is 10 also will be a don't care condition. And remaining all, I mean, M4, M12, M8, the output is 0. So we will not put an entry for that. Now we have to do the mapping. As you know, we can do 4, 8 and so on. I mean 2, 4, 8. Now since there are 8 ones, we can do the grouping. So when we do a grouping of these 8, they are all adjacent. So which changes? So D0 and D1 changes here. So they are eliminated, and D2 also changes from 0 to 1. What remains is d3 alone. So when we group this 8 ones, we get d3 as the output. Similarly, these are 4 ones left. So we can do a 8 grouping. And this x is a don't care. So we can take that as a 1. And when we group all the 8 here, so here d2 alone remains, d3 changes, and d0 and d1 changes. So therefore, the output for x is now only d2, d3. So x will be d2, d3, and it will not, all the others are don't care. Similarly, now for the output y, we have to draw the Karnaugh map in terms of d0, d1, d2, d3. So when we draw the Karnaugh map, when is y equal to 1? So y equal to 1 when d1 is 1 and 1 and when d3 is 1. So when is d1 equals to 1? So d1 is equal to 1 in these two rows. All right. So in these two rows, so we put 1, 1, 1. And when is when is d3 equal to 1? D3 is equal to 1 in these two columns. So we put 1, 1 here. All right. Next, of course, M6 and M14 don't come into this. All right. Though we have considered these cases here, this M6 and M14 will be zeros here that you can verify again. And of course, for M0, it's a don't care condition because output y is don't care. And now we do the grouping here. We can, now there are how many? 8 plus 2, 10 number of ones. So we can have 8 grouping here and 4 grouping here. So by doing 8 grouping, we eliminate D2 and D0 and D1. Only D3 remains. So D3 is there. Now by doing the grouping of these 4, we have which one changes? D0 changes, D1 remains as it is, and D2 complement remains, but D3 changes state. So therefore, this will be D1 D complement. So Y will be D3 plus D1 D complement, D2 complement. So that will be the expression, output equation for Y and X in terms of the inputs D0, D1, D2, D3. So we have derived the expressions and we have simplified the expression by using the Karnaugh map. Now, let us do the implementation of this. So as we can see from here, so the same equation Y is equal to D3 plus D1, D2 complement. So Y is equal to D3 plus D2 complement and Y, D1. So that is the output for Y. And if you see what is the output for X is D2 plus D3 or D2 or D3. So D2 and D3 are odd and you get the output X. Now V is the for the valid output. Okay, so V is 0. If V is 0, then whatever is the X and Y values, they are valid. If D is, okay, so we have seen the condition there, right? So if V is 0, then it is not a valid. If V is 1 only, then it is a valid. Okay, so that is what we have written the equation here. So V will be equal to D naught or D1 or D2 or D3. So here you already have the OR of D2 and D3. So that output itself, you can give it as an input to this. So therefore, we have got the expression for the V, which is the which will indicate whether the output is a valid output or not. So therefore, we have seen in this session the encoders. So what are encoders? It will take 2 power n inputs at the maximum and convert it into n outputs. So inputs can be 2 power n or it can be less than that. Alright. So therefore, an encoder does the reverse process of the decoder. So they are used in transmission. So whenever we want to send a message, so they will be doing encoding and decoding. So encoding at the transmission side and decoding at the reception side. So this happens in almost all the communication systems. So why they do the encoding, decoding? So that nobody gets to tamper the data that is being transmitted. That is why. All right. So far we have discussed so many topics in this unit. And we have one more topic, the multiplexers, which we will take it up in the next session. Thank you for your patience. See you in the next video.